I was coming here tonight thinking that I'm gonna be in the presence of, you know, great prayer warriors and people that have been through the battle, the McFarlands and people like Dick and Aggie that have been through many trials and tribulations. And I thought, you know, who am I to, you know, come and speak to them? They're the ones that I need to hear from. You know, there's nothing that I can share or speak or, you know, that can go anywhere close to, you know, the roads and the experience that they've went through and that they've done and that they've plowed and paved the way for people like me to just be in their presence humbly and just receive from. And so I was actually pretty humbled just to come here tonight. I was thinking, wow, you know, like, what an amazing opportunity just to be in the presence of the McFarlands. I mean, these people have gone through many battles. And if I could just be around them, then I'll glean, you know, I'll be able to glean some, you know, just some small truth. But that'll be my truth. That'll be a, you know, a small thing, but it's going to be something that God wants to give me. And I was pondering and thinking, like, wow, you know, what, you know, somebody that's been through the battle before, somebody that's been in the war before, if there's Boo. Yeah.
Yay, Boo.
Yay, Boo.
Boo's dressed for the weather. Anyway, I was pondering and thinking that, you know, God, give me a verse for the McFarlands and Dick and Aggie. And it was in Hebrews 11:34, it was talking about being valiant. Being valiant, you know, for the Lord. And I thought, you know, these people are valiant, they're brave. They've gone before, and they've paved the path. And they're valiant in truth. They're valiant in the truth, and they're valiant in the Word of God. They have clung to promises that God has given them over the years. I mean, they grabbed a hold of a truth, a principle, a promise, and they grabbed a hold of that. And they ran with it for 40 years. You know, as long as I've been alive, they've been running with the truth. As long as I've even been on the earth, they've believed God, and they've trusted God for 40 years for a promise. And God has just shown me that, you know, don't ever lose hope, don't ever lose faith. You know, Isaiah 40:31, you know, those that wait upon the Lord, you know, those that patiently wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength and mount up wings like eagles. And if, you know, if I can just get a grasp and get a, you know, just a glimpse of that truth that they've been doing for 40 years, then, you know what, then it's all worth it to me, because that's the only reason I'm here now today. I mean, 2 years ago, I all but, you know, was given up for dead, you know, and it's kind of an emotional thing, so I can't talk about it too much, but 2 years ago, you know, it was a really hard time in our life, and I thought, how am I ever going to make it through? When the doctor tells me, you don't even have hope, there's not even hope for you. And I thought, how am I ever going to make it through this time? How can I make it through a time when people tell me, you don't even have hope? And if you do have hope, you just quit living in that, because you're just living in denial. And that's what I was told. You're just living in denial, because there's no hope for you. There's nothing for you. There's nothing you can do. I don't even care if you believe in God, because I said, I know, I believe God can do something for me. And the doctor told me, well, you can believe that if you want. That's not going to help you. You can believe whatever you want to believe. But that's not true. I said, well, it's truth for me, and you know, I'm going to believe it. I'm going to believe, and that's all I had. I just had one little truth. I mean, I had a promise that I was taught in Bible college, going to this church and believing, you know, the promises of God. And Pastor Paul, you know, telling me that, you know, against all hope, Abraham believed in hope in Romans 4:18. He said, you know, we're going to believe in hope when the world says there's a door that's shut and there's no doors that you can open. We're going to believe that God's got a door for you, and he's going to keep it open in Revelation 4, you know, for the church at Philadelphia. There's a door that nobody's going to shut. The doctors can't shut it. You know, the naysayers can't shut it. You know, the doubters can't shut it. And God's going to keep it open because it's a door of faith. And this door of faith, nobody's going to shut. Nobody's going to shut. And I'm going to keep that door open for you, and I'm going to keep it open for you, and I'm going to show you great and mighty things, Scott. You know, this past year and a half has just been an incredible journey for me and my wife, and she's been right there all along with me, and she's been just a tremendous blessing. I mean, I couldn't have made it without her. I mean, we've been down as far as you can go. I mean, down. And I know there's people that can relate, and we've been down. I mean, even before I went to San Diego 3-4 weeks ago, it was getting bad. I mean, I fell on my face in the house, and I couldn't even walk up the stairs. I just fell on my face, and I guess it's over. It's all over. You know, going down. But I just kept holding on to hope.
Amen.
And even in the midst of that, you know, as bad as it got, as far down as I went, I just kept clinging on to little promises that God had given me. Just little promises of hope and encouragement. And in my mind, I kept thinking of our Les McFarland. I just kept thinking of him. I kept thinking of Arlene and what they've gone through. I kept thinking of Aggie. And I kept thinking of all the older people in Roy. And I kept thinking of, you know, Sharon McLean. I just kept thinking of, you know, the people that have gone through the battle. The people that are valiant. You know, they're valiant in truth. They're valiant in the Word of God. I mean, I just kept clinging to, you know, the warriors that have went before us. I mean, warriors of faith. I mean, that believed God and trusted God. And I said, you know what, God, I can't go by what I see. I can't go by sight. I have to go by your Word. And your Word says in 1 Kings 3:5, it says, ask. You know, ask anything, Scott. You know, ask of me, and I want to give it to you. I want to give you everything. You know, Jesus went about through all Israel healing. He healed the palsy, and he healed the sick, and he healed the man with the lame hand, and he healed the woman with the issue of blood, and he healed, and he healed, and he healed because he loved them. Because he loved them. And I said, you know what, God, you know, I know you love me personally, me individually, you love, and you care about me, and you want the best. You want to give me everything, you know, 1 John 3:5, I think, you know, he wants us to prosper and be in good health, and I know he loves me. And in Nehemiah, and I've told this to a few people, but it was so important to me. Back when I first found out, you know, in October, like in 1997, that I had some serious health problems, I found out that, and we were at the McLean's at a Bible study, and Cheryl had some books on it, some medical terms, and we looked up some definitions on some things, and we looked up Lou Gehrig's, and it was like, it was just devastating just to even look up that word. I mean, that word had death written all over it. And we looked it up, and we were like devastated. And I remember one day in October, and I have the tape today. I mean, there's this one thing you always have to remember. I mean, God, he's building up faith fields in all of us. He's building up walls of faith. And what he wants us to do is he wants us to build those walls with promises and with, you know, individual acts that he's done for us each. You know, he's given us a promise. I saved that tape. Pastor Paul, the first tape I ever saved was the tape where he taught me in Bible college. One class he taught on staying and abiding and getting taught. And don't ever leave your geographical call, you know, that God has placed you in, you know, just because of a job or something. I always want to stay where, you know, God has called you. And I saved that tape because it saved me. I'd have been gone a long time ago. But this is when I first came to this church, and he preached on that, and it just saved me. One message, one word, one tape, I saved it, and I have it. And that was a part of my wall of faith. And each person here, you know, when God, you know, he does amazing things. We pray and we ask, and he answers them, and then we forget about it. We forget about it. We forget our first love. And we can't ever forget our first love. And so these walls of faith, you know, when God gives you a promise, or you write it down in Habakkuk 2, you write down that promise. Habakkuk 2:4, you know, when God gives you a vision, you write it down, write those promises down, keep it, write it on paper, you know, keep whatever memento you have and put it on a wall and say, you know, that's a promise from God, and he's come through. He's come through before, and look at there, I remember that back in 97, I remember that back in 88, I remember he did that for me back in 1989, I remember this promise he gave me in church one day, and Pastor Paul did an amazing message, and he answered a specific prayer I had. I got that tape. It's right there on the wall, my wall of faith. That happened in 1997.
Wow.
And what happened was, when we first found out about this, we were at a, I told Glennis, I said, you know what? I said, God is, I mean, he's going to do a miracle. He's going to do a miracle on this whole thing. I don't know how it's all going to work out, but he's going to do a miracle. And I said, you know what? God is really showing me Nehemiah. I mean, we went right to the book of Nehemiah, and I started reading from Nehemiah 1. Nehemiah 1:4 was specific. You know, when Nehemiah heard the words that the people that were in Jerusalem, their walls, the temple was broken down, the walls were all broken down. And, you know, basically, to me, what it represented was their walls of faith. It was broken down, and they were broken. And these people were broken, and Nehemiah was broken because they were broken. And so Nehemiah had a call in his life, and he decided, because people are broken, I've got a call in my life to go feed those people, feed my sheep, John 21. You know, so Nehemiah wanted to go back to Israel and feed the sheep, even though he was living a life of comfort in, you know, a Persian castle, you know, as a cupbearer to the king. But Nehemiah, he had a call in his life, and he was broken. And when I heard these words about the Lou Gehrigs, I was broken. We were both broken. We were crushed. We were as far down as you can go. We were literally crawling. We had to crawl. We crawled right to pastor's office is what we did. We crawled right there. And because that's where our strength was, in the body, in with the pastor and the word. And when you're going through something, you don't go away, you go in. You know, not one thought came into my mind, well, let's just go out and do something. Whatever. It was like, no, I've got to go right to the body, right to the pastor. And then he said, let's have the whole church pray, and the whole church prayed for me. One amazing night back, you know, 1997, December 11th. I remember that night specifically. It was an amazing time. The anointing of God was so powerful that night. Pastor Kevin said it perfect. It was like the train of God, you know, the train in Isaiah. I think it's Isaiah 1:6. I can't remember, but 1:9. The train of God filled the temple, and that's what it looked like that night. It was like the presence of God was in that room, in that church that night. But getting back to this thing in Nehemiah, I told Glennis, I said, you know what? I'm broken here. We're broken, and we read the story out. We read Nehemiah out. We started in Nehemiah 1:4, and we ended up, you know, going all the way to Nehemiah 2:4, where the king said to Nehemiah, he said, Nehemiah, why are you sad? He said, what do you want, Nehemiah? He said, what do you want? I'm going to give it to you. I want to give it to you, Nehemiah. I want to give you life. You want to go build those people up back in Jerusalem? I'm going to give you what you need to build those people up. And I'm going to build you up in the process. When we go out and build other people up, we build ourselves up. You know, our walls of faith get built. So my wall of faith was being built that morning. That was a Sunday morning before church. We went to church that day. Pastor Paul wasn't speaking that day. We had Pastor Shep came in from some other church, wherever he's from, Maine or something. And he did a message, and he said, you know what, we've got a message, but the one message that I'm going to preach today, I'm not going to do it. God's changing it here. The Holy Spirit's directing me to move in another direction. He said, let's open up our Bibles to Nehemiah 1:4. It was that same exact day, that same morning that I just talked to her about. We just went to Nehemiah 1:4. We went to church that day at 2:30. New path. Pastor Shep came in. He said, let's turn the Bible right to Nehemiah 1:4. We have the tape. I mean, it was like such a confirmation word. And so we had a promise. And that's what it was. We had a promise. We had a promise. God has spoken to us individually. I mean, out of his word. He said, you know what, Scott, I love you. I love you. And you want to be healed? There's nothing that's going to stop me from that. There's nothing that I'm not, you know, he says, I'm for you. I don't care what that doctor says. I don't care what this other doctor says. I don't care what anybody says. I want you healed, you know, and because, you know what, no other reason other than that I love you. I love you, and because I love you, I want the best. You know, God doesn't take a hammer start. When we're down in the pit, he doesn't, like, grind us down further. He wants to pick us up. He wants to lift us up out of where we're at and build us up, just like Nehemiah did for those people in Jerusalem. He knew they were down and they were discouraged and they didn't have any hope. And somebody probably came to them, by the name of Sanballat, Tobiah, or Geshem probably came to Nehemiah and said, you know what? You are living in denial, Nehemiah. You can't build that wall. You're living in denial, Nehemiah. You can't build these people up. You know, you might as well just get it right, Nehemiah. There's no hope here. Even if a little fox came in, it's going to knock that wall down. And those words were spoken to us. And we know what those words are. And those are words from right from the pit of hell. And that's what I believe. I mean, that's just demonic. Satan just wants to take. He wants to take us out. We're going forward in a work of God. I mean, an amazing church. We're getting a building. We've got an amazing vision. And what's Satan want to do? Take you out. Well, I can't take him out this way. I'm going to take him out that way. I'm going to take him out whatever way I can. And he just wants to take us out of a work of God. And he wanted to take me out of a work of God. And I said, you know what? I'm going to believe a promise. God's given me a promise in Nehemiah. I'm going to hold on to it. I'm going to believe that's truth. And I'm going to look to people that have went before me, that are valiant, and that have done great and mighty exploits by believing what God has said. And I'm going to look at them, and I'm going to believe it. Because they've believed it, and they've went before me. Every one of them, they went through the battle. I don't know how to go through the battle. I don't know what to do. They do. They've been there. These people have been there. These people have been to that place before. These people have been there. I haven't been there. I don't know how to do it. And what they've always told me is just believe. You just have to believe. You just hold on to that truth, Scott. You believe what God said in His Word, and you just hold that and you run with it. And no matter what happens, no matter what happens by sight, one day it was my foot was just going real weird, twitching out and getting really shaky. And I said, my gosh, my legs are gone. I mean, immediate thought. Satan put a thought in my brain. Okay, now look at that. You think you're better here. Over here, you're not better. And that's the way the enemy works. You know, you think you're getting the truth, you're getting a revelation from him, you're getting built up, then he comes at you in the back door. And then it drove me right back to the Word. No, I don't have to believe that. No, God says that. You know, he's for me. He's not against me, he's for me. He believes all things. I can believe all things. You know, be it unto me according to my faith. I can trust God. I can go forward, and I can trust what God has said in His Word. And His Word says that, you know, those that patiently wait on Him are going to be healed. And I'm just going to continue to believe that, no matter what comes up against me. And we had amazing times of prayer. I mean, there's amazing prayer times that when we were going through these horrible times. You know, God just said, go to your knees, Scott. Go to your knees, Scott. Lay on your face, prostrate, you know, just prone before me. And that's what I was brought down to, right on my face. I mean, right on my face, right on my knees. It was God just showing me humility. Humility was what God wanted to work into me during this time too. Humility and just to get rid of all the pride. All the pride was, you know, going to go. All the pride, the only thing that was going to be left was Him. And one day in January, I was sitting on the couch, and I think Steve Burrows and Jack came over one day. And I was watching an actor, Kirk Douglas, on TV. They were doing an interview with Kirk Douglas, Spartacus, and, you know, the big macho guy in Hollywood. I can't remember some of the other movies he was in. But anyway, he had a stroke. And his whole, like, one side of his body was affected in his face, and he couldn't hardly talk. Barely could speak, and his body was all affected by that stroke, and he couldn't speak. And this person that was interviewing him said, what do you think now about all the movies you made in Hollywood? And he said, you know what? All that time that I wasted, he said, I wasted all those years in Hollywood. He said, because the only thing that matters is God. It's the only thing that matters. He says, because when I die, you know who I'm going to stand in front of? I'm not going to stand in front of all the cheering crowd and all the, you know, fans and all that. You know what I'm going to stand in front of? I'm going to stand in front of my Maker. And then it's all, it's boiled all down to that. And he said, God has shown me that all these strings that I had attached to the world are now cut off. And they're all gone. It's just me and Him, me and God, and that's it. There's nothing else. And he was so broken on TV, it broke me just watching him. Because he said that all that Hollywood stuff, all that Bravo stuff and, you know, macho stuff, that meant nothing. He said, I would throw it all away in an instant if I could have a relationship with God. And God just pointed me right to John 21. And right in an instant, God said to me, he says, Scott, do you love me? And I said, yes, Lord. He says, Scott, do you love me? I said, yes. He said, Scott, do you love me? I said, well, yes, Lord. And he said, do you love me more than your health? I said, yes. And he said, do you love me more than your family? Yes. Do you love me more than your wife, than your kids, than your church? I said, yes. He says, you know, and I was, each time he would just reiterate, do you love me, Scott? And I was getting so broken, you know, just hearing those words. I mean, in my spirit, God convicting me and saying, you know, where's your focus, Scott? Are you so worried about this disease that you can't serve me now? Is this going to all of a sudden be a God to you now? You're going to take so much time in that? And, you know, is this going to be your God now? He said, and what he was showing me was, he said, feed my sheep. You go out, you go tell the, you go preach the good news. You go share the gospel with people. You tell people about me, because I'm the one that they're going to stand in front of for all eternity. I'm the one that matters. Not this issue, that issue, this, that. Yeah. All that stuff's going to be gone. All those strings that are attached, that you have attached to the world, they're all going to be cut off in a moment. And it's just going to be me and you standing in the judgment seat. There's only 2 days we have. Heard this. We're staying in Las Vegas. All we have is today and the judgment seat, either the Bema seat or the judgment seat. All we have is 2 days. That's it. There's no other time. All the other strings were cut off. God said, all you have, Scott, is the present right now. He said, I'm going to take care of all that other stuff. Don't worry about that. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. You know, He said, don't worry about all that stuff. You put me first, and I'm going to show you the way, and I'm going to open a door for you. And I'm going to, this is nothing to me. I can do that in an instant. Don't even worry about that. That's not what I'm worried about. What I want, Scott, is I want you. That's what I want. I want you. I don't care about all this other stuff. I'll take care of all that stuff. I want you. And that's what it came down to. I mean, God brought me right to my face, right to my knees. I mean, and he said, that's it. It's just, I want you. And I want your full attention. And I want you in a relationship with me, serving me. And here I thought I was Mr. Big Christian. You know, oh, I'm serving God. I'm going forward. I thought I was Mr., you know, do everything right. And then all of a sudden I get cut right down. Cut right down. I mean, right down to the bare earth. I mean, to the dust. Right to the dust. That's where I was at, in the dust. And God said, you know, this is it. This is, I created you. I made you. I formed you. You know, and I'm the one that you're going to stand in front of for all eternity. And so, I want the priorities, you know, straight with you, Scott. And it was such an amazing time and such an amazing journey that God's, you know, brought us through. That, you know, this is just kind of, you know, the climax, coming here to be with, you know, the body. You know, the body of Christ, you know, for your 40th. Who could want anything more than to be around the church, the body of Christ? You know, these are the, you know, we weep together and we all wept together. We all wept together that, you know, I know specifically for me, we all wept together that December day. Back in 1997, we all wept together. I mean, I thought it was a goodbye ceremony, but actually it was a rejuvenation time, you know, where the body came together. We all wept together, and now it's like we're happy together. You know, we're rejoicing together. And so, you know, and what better place than the body of Christ to have your 40th birthday party? I mean, with your wife and, you know, your best friend growing up, and, you know, and the family of God that's here. You know. Their daughters and their brother. We just see Brother Boo. And I wish Brother Jeff could be here too, or Brother Mike. you know, those guys are amazing. But, you know, this has been an amazing time, and I'm thankful. Thank you, everybody, for, I mean, all the kids, too. I mean, I still have, from that day in December, you know, the kids here in the church, Johnny and Jeff and Chris and, you know, my kids and some of the other kids that aren't here, they gave me cards. I mean, I still have them. Emily Powell, you know, they wrote amazing little, they made them specifically for me. They made cards for me, you know, about, you know, Scott, you're a great man of God, you know, and God has got an amazing plan for your life. And I still have those cards today, you know, that those guys gave me. And they did, and they wrote, and they signed their names, and those mean a lot to me. Because that's the next generation here of men of faith and women of faith. I still have those cards today, and it means a lot to me. It means a lot to me. I have them. And, you know, those cards go on my wall of faith. You know, they go right up on the wall. Okay, I remember that. You know, I remember those times, but I remember they were with me. You know, those were the men and women of God that built that wall that Nehemiah had built in 52 days. Right, Pastor Jim? It was 52 days. That wall went up. And God is going to build a wall in our church. You know, our church is being built. It's being built by, you know, by men and women of God and their faith. You know, their belief in the Word and what the Word says. And then the promises of God. And then when God, you know, when in time, in our time, not like in down the road in heaven, I'm talking about right here, right now, God answers our promises and He answers our prayers right here, right now, today. Amen. And that's the real, you know, icing on the cake, you know. In heaven, hey, that'll all be great and, you know, that'll be wonderful, but I'm talking about here, right now. God answers. I mean, I wouldn't be sitting here talking like this if God wouldn't answer my prayers and all the prayers of you guys right now. I wouldn't even be here right now. Because that doctor gave me no time. And I know, and in fact, I know a lot of people, and they've called me on the phone, people with Lou Gehrig's, and one guy told me just the other day, he told me I got 2 weeks to live. So I know what it's like, and I know what, you know, when people tell you, when they throw like a time frame on you, and what matters, and how valuable the time that we have is, you know, this time that God has given us right now, this day, today, you know, how valuable it is. And so I know that, you know, God, you know, He answers our prayers today, right now. And this isn't a prayer of mine that's been answered, just being at my 40th party with the body of Christ, you know, being able to talk. I thank God I can talk. You know, people take it for granted. I don't take it for granted. I thank God I can talk. I thank God I can speak. I thank God I can raise my hand. I thank God I can walk. I thank God for that. You know, because that stuff that we take so many things for granted. I don't take it for granted. I thank God. And so, but I know also that He can answer prayers, and He does it in our time, in our space of time, here on the earth while we're alive. I've seen my mom and dad get saved during this time too. When I talked to my dad, and he's in all those pictures, he's Mr. They won the state championship this year in football. They were undefeated, 14-0. And my dad was a, you know, Marine drill instructor. Who's my dad? You know, he's a real tough guy. But you know what? I've seen my dad get broken, you know, on the phone, and with me personally, and I shared the gospel with him, and I saw him, and I heard my dad tell me on the phone. I said, Dad, you know what? I don't care if I die. All I care about is I just want you to come to. I just want you to enter into a relationship with Christ. I want to see you forever. I don't want it to end here on the earth. I don't want it to end here. I want it to go beyond today. I want it to go forever. And I got to share that with my dad, and he told me, he said, you know what, Scott? He says, you know what, Scott, I want you to know this. I believe. I believe. I said, Dad, you know, that means more to me than anything. So I don't care what happened to me. Also, you know, you saying that to me, I believe. And that you trust, you know, Christ as your Savior. That means more to me than anything. And he said, you don't have to worry about your mom either, because she does too. And I said, praise God, you know what? It's all worth it just to hear that. Amen. There's a soul going to heaven. And that's not the end of it. That's the beginning.
That's right.
You know, that's just the start. And so So God is answering our prayers right here, right now, today, and He's building walls up of faith. He's building us up like you cannot imagine. He's built me up from the pit. He's taken me from the literal pit of hell where Satan stood right over me and laughed at me and said, when I walked in the pastor's office before I got there, Satan said, "Where's your God now, you Mr. Christian? Where's your God now? He's left you. You're all on your own now." God said, "No, no, that's a lie. Don't believe that. That's a lie because I've got the body. And you just stay in that body and you grow in that body and you thrive in that body and you're gonna become, you know, who I want you to be in that body. Don't ever leave it. You know, just grow and thrive and become who I want you to be in the body and trust me. You just trust me day by day." I had a guy tell me once, you know, he said, "What if God doesn't heal you?" I think he's come to church a couple times. I didn't even know who he was. And it kind of devastated me, but I thought, you know what? God could be true. I don't know. What if he doesn't? All I know is I'm going to trust God today. I don't know if down the road 40 years from now, or thank God I'm here today after 40 years, but I don't know 40 years from now where I'm going to be. I mean, I could be in heaven. I mean, any one of us could not be here tomorrow. And so, all I know is God loves me today. He cares about me today, right here, right now, today. And I'm building a wall of faith today. And I'm going to just remember that the rest of my life. I mean, he's building a wall of faith in me, and he's building each one of us up like we cannot imagine. He's building this. I've seen this church just grow tremendously in the time that I've been here. I've seen my best friend come out from Wisconsin. You know, this is amazing to see this great man of God come out. This guy's just an amazing, and what he's doing with, you know, where he's working at the program with all those guys that he brings out to church every week. He brings them faithfully out. They sit in the back, but Jerry brings them out faithfully. Always. He's always thinking of somebody else. You know, others. He's just an amazing soul winner. Just loves the Word of God. He said he just can't wait to, you know, give a testimony about Vancouver. You know, what's going on in Vancouver? But, so I see, you know, God is building us up. He's building up an amazing, you know, amazing body. Greater Grace, you know, in Las Vegas and Baltimore. You know, he's building up an amazing body. And if we get our eyes off, you know, all these other things that are going on and just focus, you know, on the Word, what does the Word say, and just getting to know the mind of God for the moment, then, you know what, there's nothing that we can't do and that we can't accomplish. We can build a wall in 52 days. We can build a wall in one day. You know, we're building a wall today. You know what? That wall that Nehemiah took 52 days to build, we're building it today. That wall is being built right now. Right here, right now. And so, all I can say is, you know, praise God. Thank you for everybody coming out. It's been an amazing journey for me and Greater Grace. I've been in for 12 years, I think. 12 years. 12 years, we've had some fun times here. We've played some amazing football games. We've had a lot of fun. And don't look at any of these pictures if I look funny in them. That was probably my brother. We look alike, you know. It wasn't me. So anyway.